Normal people become terrified of criminals.
Shots were just fired. Police just came out and told us, and we're headed there right now.
They become terrified of their own government.
The New York Times. Are black voters leaving Democrats behind? They say polls suggest they might be. Well, we looked at an NBC poll that I think showed Trump with 24% of the black vote. And if that's true, according to the Wall Street Journal several years ago, they wrote an article in like 2018 that said that if Democrats can't maintain 80%, if Republicans ever get more than 20, the Democrats are, they can't win at all. So I'm not sure I believe these things, right? There's been a lot of conservative personalities who said you are insane to think black voters are going to move towards Trump in any way. The New York Times asks the question, and then the New York Post runs this story. Trump poll Trump polling lead expands with Biden losing black and Hispanic support. So I'm wondering if it's not so much that Trump is gaining, but that because Biden is losing, it results in a vote vacuum. You don't need to vote for Trump if you're not voting. Trump is still going to create a gap by having people not vote for Joe Biden.
Right. Yeah. I think that's going to happen. People are realizing, I saw a lot of people this weekend, I forget what it was, but people realizing that they had life better underneath Trump than they have under Biden. I think that's as simple as that.
They say Biden's lead among Hispanic voters is now 3%, down from 14 in an Emerson poll last November. Wow, an 11-point shift. They say Biden's lead among African Americans was still substantial, 47, but down 15 points. And then there was that poll in New York. Biden is up 10 points in a D plus 27. Yeah, he's only up 10.
Wow. Trump's also New York. You know, yeah, there's a lot of people in New York who still love Trump and who understood Trump before a lot of the country did. Because if you're from New York, you know the certain type of character that
you
Trump
know this
was.
Guy.
Yeah,
he's not all of these things. He's this big, bombastic.
Right.
Kid from Queens.
He wasn't shocking to us.
No.
You know, when we saw him.
Certainly
but
not.
For a lot of the country, it was like, whoa, what is this?
The New York Times is saying Trump's lead, his support among black voters is 22%. So up several points. They say in 2020, Biden defeated Trump by 4.5 in the popular vote, though he won by much narrower margins in the swing states that saw him. And now, look, I think it's ultimately, I wonder why we even talk about this stuff a year out.
That's the thing. So much is going to change. If, for example, Ron DeSantis wins in Iowa, which there's a very strong likelihood that he will, he's locked up 30,000 precinct or
and he's working real hard.
Chairs,
right now,
he's working real hard. Yep. Then from January 15th through Super Tuesday, anything can happen. Just anything can happen, and particularly in an election where going into the spring, all of Trump's legal problems catch up with him.
Yeah, that's true.
And so among the many things that can happen, we could be running someone from jail. I mean, that is not an impossible scenario given how upside down, topsy-turvy the world is now. And certainly not constitutionally prohibited either. My view of this, I borrow this from my friend Alan Estrin over at PragerU. He points out that narrative is an actual force in the universe, sort of like gravity. It's not, narrative isn't something that we do. It's something that we observe. And if you go by that theory, then at a minimum, the story belongs to Donald Trump. It is Donald Trump's story. It doesn't mean he wins the election. But I don't think people are ready. We haven't gotten to the end of the Donald Trump story yet.
Yeah.
And people want to know what the end of the Donald Trump story is more than they want to know what the next story is.
So true. Yeah. I love narrative. You can feel it. It is a substance in the world.
Carl Benjamin made this point to me.
He did.
This is like a year and a half ago. I was saying I thought DeSantis was the right choice. He had a better temperament, proven leadership. Not that Trump, you know, didn't, but Trump's temperament wasn't there. And then Carl messaged me saying Trump's arc is not done. Trump's story must be completed. He made a video about it. And now things have shifted. So you think, even with Trump's legal problems, this lends itself to Trump winning and or at least very well being the nominee and making it to November?
Well, whether he's the nominee or not, I think that maybe he takes the entire Republican Party down. Like maybe, for example, Ron DeSantis wins Iowa. He gets a big boost going into South Carolina. He somehow gets past Nikki Haley there. Ron DeSantis becomes the nominee. Donald Trump splits the party and says he won't back Ron DeSantis. Donald Trump loses the election for Republicans, or DeSantis somehow wins and pardons Donald Trump, and it's the greatest, you know, whatever it is. It's like whatever the craziest thing we can imagine. Somehow the Donald Trump story still hasn't ended,
and the most likely outcome is the most Entertaining, is that what Elon says?
Yes, the most likely outcome is
Elon's razor.
It's going to end with Trump outside the White House jumping midair, then freeze frame.
Yeah.
And we're just back to normal. Finally.
I mean, fair point. I mean, but really, if you think about it, Trump's story arc can end in a lot of really crazy ways.
Oh, yeah. Not,
for sure.
They're not all good.
Right, you know? Right. That. Like January 6th, nobody saw coming. Mm-mm. Imagine January 6th times 10 with an angry Donald Trump and some whatever his story arc becomes. Mm-hmm. Now, I guess the difference there is Trump was actually president when January 6th mm-hmm. was going down. He could have done a lot of things he did not do. Now he's not president. There's a lot of things he can't do. And so those just won't happen. But weird things can happen. My bigger concern is probably his story could end rather unceremoniously through health issues.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I mean, in both the external and internal, certainly someone could hurt him.
Mm-hmm.
Or he could quite literally just at 77... you know,
yeah.
Be shuffled loose the mortal coil.
What I'm worried about is like we've been witnessing absurdity like exponentially grow every year over the past few years. What is next year's October surprise going to be? It's going to be so terrifying and absurd. You know, like I'm also, you know, they've been dropping these hints lately about the internet apocalypse, you know, because solar flares.
Right.
Right.
Is that going to happen? Like, are we not going to be able to talk and communicate anymore?
I keep wondering about that. And I'm like, you know, we really should have kept up with the United States Postal Service.
You know, I want to entertain that possibility because just imagine this scenario. It's a week before the election and solar flare, internet is cut out.
Seriously.
Internet's gone. Yeah. And the only thing available now is radio and terrestrial television.
So we're in radio.
And so what happens is you've got no internet. Industry is collapsed. But you turn the TV on and there's your good friend Wolf Blitzer letting you know that Joe Biden won. Trust him.
Oh, that's it.
Well, wouldn't it be nice if we had paper ballots before the solar flare takes out the grid?
That would be so nice. They had paper ballots in Argentina.
We need to push that.
How long did it take him to count those votes? Three months?
I think it was just one. I think it was just the one day.
One
day.
Impossible.
Really, I don't understand.
Just the one day.
That's
I know. I think they were, you know, even just.
They may try to turn off the country and turn it back on again. Internet goes down just in time for the election and nobody can communicate. Nobody can organize.
They did essentially do that in 2020. They basically shut down the world.
Yeah, true.
And, then tried to turn it back on again. And we still,
we've
come nowhere near the end of the consequences.
Right.
That's crazy.
And back then, as terrible as that was, we could still subvert their narrative because we could communicate through the internet.
Mm-hmm.
They know now they got to get rid of that so we can't subvert them. So we have to make ham radios and homing pigeons some way to communicate.
Ham-fi.
Let's do it.
You got to get
our bank accounts.
Very difficult.
Tim Ham doesn't sound very good. I don't know. That might be.
Well, no, we want ham internet.
Yeah, I know.
So we data transmission through ham, which is ridiculously slow.
Hamnet. I like it.
You're better off just talking.
Yeah. On the street.
Go outside and shout.
That's it. Yeah.
But seriously, imagine just actually imagine what it would be like if it was 3 days before the election and there's no internet at all. And we all are old enough to remember life before the internet.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. There's a lot of young people who do not.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
It's glorious in many ways.
You know, actually, it's kind of crazy to think about. There's 20-year-olds who do not know life without access to the internet.
Mm-hmm.
There are younger children. Man, it's 2023, so a kid born in 2000, let's be realistic. Born in 2000, you are not old enough to understand life and cell phones and internet.
No.
By the time you are 7 or 8, cell phones are ubiquitous.
Yep.
By the time you're 13, everyone's got one.
Yep.
Now you're 23 years old. You have never lived a moment without instant access information cell phone. And there's never been a point at which you've lost that.
Yeah.
You've gone to dead zones. You've been out at parties in the desert where there's no connectivity, but you've never been in a city with no internet.
Right.
That's crazy.
That's where that fracturing that we were talking about earlier is going to take place, you know, because those people at that age, their identity online means as much to them as their identity out here.
Exactly.
Which is pretty
profile.
Sad, but like what you were saying earlier, hopefully there's some people who realize like we reject that. We want real life. We want a family. We're going to go to the supermarket.
But
we
it's
want
not
to see
sad.
People.
It is necessary. It's necessary to, you know, curate your online presence because otherwise your online presence is going to come back and get you fired from your job.
Yeah.
So you got to be careful of it.
Yeah. Yeah.
I do think that more kids are kind of like of the Gen Z. And if I can use my, you know, just this year teenage son as an example, they're much more interested in being anonymous online. They don't want to put their names out there. They don't even necessarily want to put their faces out there.
Wow.
You know, they want to be in person with their friends and they want to have whatever the curated thing, but they don't put as much stock in their identity online.
That's good.
They use it. They do a lot of jokes.
Just trolling.
Just a lot of that stuff.
Isn't that what Hochul wants to get rid of in her
plan?
Yeah,
like I said, my son watches Matt Walsh.
I'm anti-anonymity on the internet.
Really? I like it.
To what degree? Because I think it's appropriate for people to be able to be anonymous for various reasons, but it's also, I think, it's weak for people too, especially if you go after people.
I don't think that it's... Here's the problem. The problem is that anonymity on the internet allows for the ghettoizing of beliefs that are not approved by the regime. So a lot of people will say, well, I have to be anonymous on the internet because if my boss finds out that I've got these views, they'll fire me. But you're only in the position where your boss could fire you for finding out about those views because you've allowed those views to be completely ghettoized through anonymity online. Hmm. If 5 million people came out today and said the N-word, I'm not recommending it, but no one would ever get fired for saying the N-word again.
Thanks for watching this clip from the Timcast IRL podcast. Hang out with us live Monday through Friday at 8 p.m. and become a member over at timcast.com for uncensored, members-only shows exclusive. Thanks for hanging out, and we'll see you all next time.